In the last session, we saw how the key junction points help in integrating between carbohydrate, protein and lipid. We also saw how carbohydrates can be converted to protein and how proteins can be converted to carbohydrate, how carbohydrates can be converted to lipid, but the reverse does not take place and there is no net conversion between proteins and lipids. Now, we saw that this is happening. Is this regulated? How is it regulated? There comes the role of different hormones within the body. So how do these hormones help in the regulation of this integration? Which are the hormones? Now, there are basically three groups of hormones. The hormones of the pancreas, that is insulin and glucagon, hormones of the anterior pituitary, ACTH, TSH, growth hormone, hormones of the adrenal medulla, adrenaline, noradrenaline. These hormones are the ones which are important in regulating the integration between the different metabolisms. So let us look at the pancreatic hormones. What is glucagon? Glucagon is a hyperglycemic hormone. It increases the blood glucose level by stimulating glycogenolysis, gluconeogenesis, etc. So insulin is the hypoglycemic hormone. It is going to break down your blood glucose level. It decreases blood glucose. How? By seeing to that either that it is stored or seeing to that it is getting catabolized. So glycolysis or by glycogenesis, that is storage of glucose as glycogen. What is the role of anterior pituitaries? Now the anterior pituitary is under the control of the hypothalamus. So the hypothalamus of the brain controls the anterior pituitary. Now ACTH, adrenocorticotropic hormone, what does it do? It acts via the glucocorticoids. Which are the most important glucocorticoid is cortisol. And it increases blood glucose level by stimulating the same as that of glucagon, but mainly by stimulating glycogenolysis and gluconeogenesis. And just look over here, anterior pituitary hormones. What's the role of growth hormone in all this? Now, growth hormone has insulin-like action. It is an anabolic hormone. It sees to that protein synthesis takes place. It acts on the liver and produces what is called as insulin-like growth factor. It is the IGF which is responsible for many actions of growth hormone. What about thyroid hormones? TSH. Out of thyroid, before TSH, the anterior pituitary hormone is thyroid stimulating hormone. Now TSH acts on the thyroid gland, releases T3 and T4. So these TSH acts via the thyroid hormones, and thyroid hormones regulate the metabolic rate. So your basal metabolic rate is regulated by thyroid hormones. So whole metabolisms, all the metabolisms are regulated by TSH and T3 and T4. Now let us look at the hormones of the adrenal medulla. Epinephrine and norepinephrine. Both these are also hyperglycemic hormone. They increase glycogenolysis. Please remember that epinephrine action is on the muscle and not on the liver. Increase lipolysis, see to that more of hormone sensitive lipase is activated and more of lipids are converted to acetyl-CoA, and basically they increase the blood glucose and free fatty acids. When are they released? They are released in response to stress. So whenever there is a fear or flight or fight response, that is when they are released. Fear, flight or fright response, adrenaline is released, and adrenaline will act on glycogenolysis or lipolysis to increase the blood glucose levels and the free fatty acids. Now let us look at the integration of metabolism at the cellular level. That we saw how it is happening at the cellular level. Let us look at the organ level, inter-organ relationship between different organs in under different states. So let us look at how these metabolic pathways are interrelated, how each tissue is going to help another tissue. So now different physiological states, let us look. Now in all this, please remember there is always a homeostasis of metabolism taking place. All cells use ATP and constantly require supply of sources of energy, the nutrients, carbohydrate, lipids and protein, for generation of ATP. So homeostasis is balance between the sources of energy and energy requirement of tissue, and this is balance is regulated and carried out by three signals or markers: blood levels of sources of energy, blood levels of hormone which regulate metabolic homeostasis, and also nerve impulses which have an impact or effects on the tissue metabolism or on the secretion of hormones by the target endocrine glands. So let us look like this, how these signals work. So you have sources of energy from the diet, carbohydrate, protein, lipid. What do? They are a constituent of the blood nutrient. So what? They are used for ATP, physiological functions within the different cells and tissues. What else do? They are stored as sources of energy, maybe glycogen in the liver and muscle, triacylglycerol in the adipose tissue. And this storage is stimulated by insulin. The release is stimulated by glucagon, adrenaline, cortisol, all of which are acting on the enzyme hormone sensitive lipase. The blood proteins, what else can it do? It can help in growth. The growth can be either longitudinal or horizontal, depending on the age. Till a particular age, the children will keep on growing longitudinally. After some time, they will start growing horizontally. So I would say growth can occur in all the directions. So growth, and this ATP is also used for all these growth purposes, and the stored form of also is used for growth. And these neuronal signals can have an effect on the sources of energy, that is how much you are going to eat and how much is going to be absorbed depends upon neuronal signal. Its use of blood nutrients for ATP, neuronal signal. Its using ATP for growth, neuronal signal. If you insulin release, neuronal signal. If it is going to act on growth itself, again we need neuronal signal. Release of these hormones, neuronal signal. Everywhere, whole thing is going to be controlled by neuronal signals, that is the brain. The brain can have an effect on all these, at all these levels, whether it is the release of a hormone or whether it is storage of a particular nutrient or whether it is the release of a particular nutrient. These signals are also coordinated. Now let us look what is happening after a meal. You have eaten a good breakfast, you have eaten a good lunch, or you have eaten a good dinner. What happens after a meal? What are the changes that are taking place? How all these changes are being done? What are the role of hormones in all these changes? So we call this post-absorptive state or the well-fed state, the absorptive state or the well-fed state of the body. Now this involves a 2 to 4 hour period after ingestion of a normal meal. We call it the absorptive state. What happens? There is increase in blood glucose, amino acids and triacylglycerol. From where? This is all what has been taken up from the diet. Glucose has been absorbed, digested and absorbed. Digestion has taken place, absorption. So there is increase in blood glucose, increase in the amino acid which has come from proteins, and triacylglycerol. Remember the chylomicrons. Whatever TAG have been broken down have reformed triacylglycerol, and they are in the chylomicron state and they are getting transported everywhere along the body. Now what happens? These glucose, amino acids and triacylglycerol stimulate the release of insulin from the beta cells. At the same time, inhibit the release of glucagon from the alpha cells. So please remember that we have two cells, beta cells and the alpha cells. Both of these are present in the pancreas. Okay, both of these are present in the pancreas. Now what will happen? The same signal can stimulate one, at the same time inhibit the other. Okay, this is what is happening. A same signal can stimulate one and inhibit other. So, and that will help in regulating the whole metabolism. So, it stimulates the release of insulin and inhibits the release of glucagon. So, what will happen? There will be increased insulin, decreased glucagon. So, we call it insulin-glucagon ratio is increased. So, what will be its effect? The effect will be on liver, on brain, on adipose tissue and skeletal muscle. Now these are the major organs present within our body. Which are they? They are the liver. What else is there? We have the brain. Okay, we have the brain. We have the adipose tissue. And we have a huge chunk of skeletal muscle. Huge chunk of skeletal muscle. So all this integration will occur between these organs, the brain, the liver, the skeletal muscle and the adipose tissue. Now let us see its effects on each state, what is happening in the well-fed state. Insulin glucagon ratio is increased. Now what does it do? let us look at the different pathways that are stimulated or increased by insulin. By now you should be able to tell what is increased. It increases entry of glucose into the peripheral tissues. So we have high glucose level. Glucose levels are high. What happens? This glucose is enters into adipose tissue, enters into the skeletal muscle. And what is present here? It is a transporter. What is a transporter? Glucose transporter 4. And what increases the glucose transporter 4? Insulin, which has been released from the pancreas. This will see to that glucose transporter 4 go from the cytoplasm to the cell membrane from in both the adipose tissue and the skeletal muscle. Then what happens? So glucose utilization is increased in all the tissues. Glucose utilization by glycolysis. I'll just write it like this. Glycolysis occurs in all the tissue. One, it has entered inside. Secondly, glycolysis is going to occur in all the tissues. Everywhere it is going to be stimulated, all this glucose. So when glucose goes to all the tissues, what will happen? The blood glucose level is going to come down. So glycolysis is stimulated in all the tissues. But at the same time, there is so much of glucose. So what else will insulin do? It will see to that it is going to be stored as glycogen. It is going to be stored, excess glucose is stored as glycogen. It is stored as glycogen in the liver and in the muscle. So in both the liver and the muscle, it stimulates glycogen synthesis, glycogenesis in the liver and the muscle. Still extra glucose is there. Here it has formed glycogen. What about in the adipose tissue? In the adipose tissue, what will happen? Extra glucose is stored as triacylglycerol. It is stored as triacylglycerol. TAG formation takes place. So lipogenesis is stimulated, glycogenesis is stimulated, glycolysis is stimulated. So, and what about protein synthesis? Suppose extra, still more glucose is there. Remember, carbohydrates can be converted to proteins. All the amino acids are there. Translation can take place. Protein synthesis can take place. And it can result in the formation of different proteins. Proteins are formed. Different proteins are formed. Either they are released from the liver into the plasma, or they are present in the skeletal muscle. In the skeletal muscle, protein synthesis in the all tissues, wherever proteins are required, neurotransmitters are required, all those will be synthesized in various tissues. So protein synthesis, especially in the liver and the muscle, take place. Growth will take place in the muscle. When it takes place, growth will take place. Okay, what is decreased? What are the things that are decreased? One, we don't want extra glucose to be formed. So gluconeogenesis is going to be inhibited. We don't want lipolysis to take place to release glucose. So the reverse is what is inhibited. The reverse of triacylglycerol degradation is inhibited. The formation of gluconeogenesis from different amino acid is inhibited. So gluconeogenesis is inhibited in the liver, in the kidney. Glycogenolysis in the liver and the muscle is inhibited, and lipolysis in the adipose tissue is inhibited. So these are the things that are happening in the well-fed state. Protein catabolism is also inhibited. So the net effect of this high insulin is increase in the anabolic pathways, growth and storage, and inhibition of the catabolic pathways. So let us look at the liver. What else is happening in the well-fed state? Okay. Now please note that the liver is the nutrient distribution center. It is the center from where all the nutrients are carried to the different parts of the body. It is also noted for its unique blood supply. It is having blood supply from the portal vein and also from the hepatic vein. So this is the site where blood, which is coming from the intestine, is reaching the liver first. A nutrient-rich blood reaches the liver. At the same time, systemic circulation is also reaching the liver. So it is a unique blood supply is there. So this prevents broad fluctuation in the availability of nutrients to the peripheral tissue. It acts like the main source, the gate from where to different tissues, how nutrients have to reach is all regulated by the insulin. So carbohydrate, let us look at what's happening in the liver as far as carbohydrate, protein and lipid metabolism is concerned. Already told you this is under the action of insulin. Once you know that, it is easy to remember that when in the well-fed state, glycolysis is occurring, glycogenesis is occurring, glycogenolysis is inhibited, and we know that these are all regulated by insulin. So it utilizes glucose, increase in glycolysis, glycogenesis, HMP shunt, TCA cycle. Enzymes which will be active include all the glycolytic enzymes, glycogen synthase and pyruvate dehydrogenase. And pathways and enzymes which will be inhibited will be gluconeogenesis and glycogenolysis. This is just from MCQ point of view that you should be knowing about it. So in the liver, what else is happening? In the fat metabolism, until now I was talking about carbohydrate metabolism. So let us look at the fat metabolism that is taking place in the liver. Maybe what will happen in the well-fed state, glycolysis is taking place, there is TAG synthesis. TAG synthesis takes place, we call this, again I'm showing TAG like this. All this is going out of this as VLDL. So there is increased release of VLDL. What does VLDL do? This is an endogenous skeletal muscle. It takes it to the adipose tissue. It transports whatever TAG is got. It goes to the different tissue. And so there is fat metabolism, increased de novo synthesis of fatty acids, TAG synthesis, VLDL synthesis, and the enzyme which is active is acetyl-CoA carboxylase. Now, what about amino acid metabolism? There is degradation of the surplus amino acid. Remember that amino acids are not stored and liver cannot metabolize the branched chain amino acid. There is increased protein synthesis to replace the protein degraded. Maybe whatever proteins have been degraded, all that will be synthesized. The plasma proteins will be synthesized and they will be sent out into the circulation. So now let us look at adipose tissue. One, we already know that glycolysis is taking place, plus glycolysis can be converted to acetyl-CoA, de novo synthesis and storage as lipogenesis and being getting stored as triacylglycerol. Please remember that glycerol kinase is absent in the adipose tissue. So glycerol kinase comes from action of glycerol kinase and glycerol 3-phosphate is what is coming from liver to here to form triacylglycerol. So let us look at it. Increased glucose transporter. Please remember GLUT4 is causing, insulin has caused translocation of GLUT4. Increased glycolysis. This may supply glycerol 3-phosphate for TAG synthesis. Adipose tissue does not contain glycerol kinase. And increased HMP shunt to provide NADPH for fatty acid synthesis. Lipid metabolism, increased synthesis of fatty acid. This is theoretically possible actually. And increased uptake of fatty acids from chylomicron, dietary and VLDL. And the enzyme is lipoprotein lipase. And thereby increased synthesis of triacylglycerol. Decreased breakdown of TAG, that is hormone sensitive lipase, is inhibited by insulin by dephosphorylation. So this is the well-fed state adipose tissue. Now we'll go on to the well-fed state skeletal muscle. Again, we are looking at the integration resting skeletal muscle. I'm not talking of a muscle which is fasting and it is having exercise. No, let us look at only the resting skeletal muscle in the well-fed state. So carbohydrate uptake, glycolysis, glycogen synthesis. Fat metabolism, again VLDL lipoprotein lipase. So increased TAG is got, fatty acids are broken down and they may give energy to it. Amino acids, increased protein synthesis, increased uptake of branched chain amino acid for both either energy or for protein synthesis. What is happening in the brain? Brain, what does it do in the well-fed state? Carbohydrate, glycose, glucose and glucose. Brain is dependent on glucose. So whatever glucose is there, glycolysis, pyruvate, acetyl-CoA, TCA cycle, all are active. Gives energy to the brain. Glucose is used as an exclusive fluid. Fat metabolism, not stores of DHA. Our brain is not filled with lipid. I mean, it may be filled with sphingomyelins and all other different lipids, but not with triacylglycerol. So no stores of DHA. Fatty acids cannot cross the blood-brain barrier effectively. So fatty acids are usually not used as source of. So during the well-fed state, if you look at the different integration, I've just showed to you what is happening. What is happening in different tissues. Insulin, pancreas releases insulin, result in the transport across the membrane, glucose transporter 4 comes, glycolysis, there is lipogenesis, and at the same time VLDL is also giving its THE to adipose tissue, to muscle, all extra glucose is being stored, glycolysis is taking place in different tissues, net anabolism is taking place, wherever proteins have to be synthesized, they are being synthesized, glycogen synthesis is taking place and it is getting stored, and THA synthesis is taking place. This is the inter-organ relationship during the well-fed state. Now in the next session, we'll see what will happen in the during fasting. Is there any changes that are happening? What are the hormonal changes that are going to take place, and what is the state of different metabolisms during the fasting state. Thank you.